Jay.
Later, bro. Love you.
Let's walk doors a little bit.
Okay.
I'm too cool for you.
How you doing? Welcome to New York. Excuse me.
Stop. Stop following me.
Like I'm nervous that if he touches, if he hits the building or something like that.
No.
Here, hold it.
Shit.
Yeah.
Holy shit!
Hey, I gave him to you. Now pick him up. It's not that easy. It's way heavier than 50 pounds.
It's good. It's good.
Do it
again.
You guys are dropping off on the 12th floor?
16th floor.
16th floor?
But you said you're going to do it, right?
That's the floor it's supposed to be?
It's supposed to be the 12th floor. But you said you were going to do it, right?
I'll do it. Yeah, air bed.
We got an air bed, an air mattress. Should be good.
I'll do it.
Close?
If you fell onto an air mattress from the 12th floor, you would die.
Yo, I looked at that fight scene the other day. Me and
you and Caleb
watching it. Yeah, I'm so horrible back then. So inexperienced. Boxing just.
You like that scene? Remember how many times you rolled down the hill?
He just showed up. What the fuck? You trying to set me up or something?
No, I'm not trying to set you up.
So where's
I'm
he
trying
at
to fucking
then?
Tell you what's
where's
going
he at
on.
Then?
I don't know. He said he'd be
where's
here.
Where's the last time you seen him?
86
Street. Last time I'm going out. He's gonna kill me. I'm gonna fucking kill him. I'm
Yo,
tired of this.
Dude, wait
shit.
Up for me.
No, wait for nothing. Hey. I gotta wash my fucking ass every day. Now I gotta deal with this shit.
Stop.
Elliot! You're done.
Stop it.
Mike! You're done.
Mike, stop it. Mike, stop. Mike, stop.
Tap out. Tap out. Tap out.
Mike!
I'll put you to sleep. Tap out.
Mike!
Good.
He's gonna calm down. He's gonna walk the fuck away.
Idiot, please stop.
Because next time I'll fucking kill you. Next time I'll take your fucking life, bro. You want more or are you good?
Yeah, at one point he wanted me to keep a journal. You know? Of what jail was like. I was locked up for a little while in Rikers. And he wanted me to keep a journal. Like, you know, from hour to hour, what it's like in there. To help with the, you know, jail scenes in this movie. I think Josh and Benny are really, they're really on point with what they do. Like, they don't just rush from one scene to the next. They really want to nail the scene. They want to get it perfect.
And chin up for me.
What?
Oh yes.
I mean, we're doing pickups now because we didn't have an end to this movie yet. And we knew that we were going to have to do this, but I still hate doing pickups. It's really hard to get back into the swing of things after months of being away. They're very different guys than when I first met them. And their roles complement each other extremely well. Josh on set is very visual, but also he's extremely present with judging the acting and working with the actors and everything. And Benny's more logical, everything goes to Benny, and then he figures out the mess.
Yeah. I'm just wondering, for the sake of the edit, Benny, if that would.
It does. It hurt. It hurts us.
Yeah.
Because we need a pause. You need to find where the scream is coming from before you react.
I think they always want to make a movie that people are going to see. They're actually very kind of commercially oriented. They want to make popular movies. They're not trying to alienate people. So that's for real.
Benny, he needs to look out and then crane himself outward so he can really see, basically almost the windows of the lobby. Benny, be careful up there.
I know, trust me, I'm very scared.
Roll sound.
Okay, let's roll sound.
Sound speeds.
Speeding.
Sound speeds. 50, take 3. Marker.
Marker.
Okay. Motherfucker. Oh.
It's very difficult to redress the dummy, so if it's just the wig that we're worried about, let's just do the dummy.
Wow, that's the best one.
Second one where I'm like this.
That's the best one. This is the one we just did.
Do them. Show that one. Here. Ready? Look how much better this is. Look at that. No, the second one. The second one was the best. Do the second one.
The one I just played.
No, the other one.
This one, because there's a shot.
Not the one you just showed. Not the one before it. The other one. The other one. Look at the other one. Ready?
It's the first one. But your head hits the fucking pit thing.
Ready? Watch. Look.
That actually is the most realistic. We got on the first try.
What's this guy's move? I got.
He's
here,
like.
Here we go. Oh, what is it, little man?
I've never seen him cry this much.
Oh.
Okay. He's a big fan of wings.
That's good.
Yeah.
This neighborhood that where our office is, we chose it, largely for that. Like, Penn Station being removed, being demolished, and being replaced with Madison Square Garden, and what we have today as Penn Station, was the greatest possible thing that could happen in New York. It actually preserved a lot of important buildings, largely, Grand Central and, the MetLife building that went above it. It endured because Penn Station did not. But Penn Station becoming what it is today, that underground inferno, it's a zombie land. But it's important because if it still looked the way that it did then, it would have the same things that Grand Central has, which is a steakhouse, a lobster, an oyster, these are great places. Grand Central Station has an Apple store in it. Penn Station for a long time had a big bin of beer that you can you grab before you get on the train to go home. I mean, they actually just got rid of the contract for these two brothers who own all of those shops, and they're starting to kind of make it a little nicer.
And all they could do is raise the ceiling.
Exactly,
like
but
2 inches.
If Penn Station was what it was, this office would not be nearly affordable. This whole neighborhood would be completely different. And, because it is still very much what it felt like when they built that building, it's preserved the city in a strange way. I think it's important. You got to have extremes. And you have Grand Central, and it's beautiful. And you have Penn Station, which is ugly. I like that people come into the city through Penn Station, and they say, this is horrible. I'm going to get the fuck out of here. I love that. I know people who just damn Penn Station all the time, and I love it.
Well, our dad was a runner for a Diamond District guy. And, those... You can't trust any of them. I mean, that's in our blood in a weird way. The con hustler. I mean, on our dad's side, it was.
Yeah, it's just
it went. It ran deep.
And it's just like everybody's doing it in the city, and you just kind of see it. And there's just something very human about it because everybody's trying.
Everybody's trying really hard.
The integral part of a con is the interaction.
I'm not talking
between,
about a con.
The interaction between two people, though.
But I'm not talking
because
about a
con.
I'm talking about hustling, you know, which isn't necessarily a con. It's just a matter of trying to get by as best as you can. And that's a very human thing. Seeing somebody try, and most of the time for me, seeing somebody fail, is a very human, it's a very human thing to witness. And you can, you kind of can't get closer to a person in a weird way.
I gotta go to work.
No, wait.
I'm already really late.
Wait till he finishes his deal. You might spook him, and then he'll lose the sale.
$5.50?
Yeah.
Without trying it, you mean?
I'm not gonna let you in my apartment, all right? Just...
You know what? Let me try it at home.
Listen,
how about let me try it out at home, and then... if I like it, I'll come back and give you the money.
Very funny, all right? There's people pull this on me all the time.
Yeah,
listen,
I'm trying.
You're not going to try
it. I live close by.
I understand that.
Let me try it at home.
Very funny.
And then
don't take the fucking computer, right? Just get the fuck out of here, man, all right? Don't touch me. Don't touch me.
I got a knife. You're going to lose the computer now, okay? I'm just going to stick on it. And I'll cut you.
All right, Skippy, drop that knife. Freeze. Put your hands on the wall. Put your hands on the wall.
What are you doing in there?
I'm his friend. Spread them. Face forward, spread them.
I knew I shouldn't have did this.
All right,
my name is Mitchell. I'm
not
Joe.
What do you want to do with this mutt?
Just get him out of here. I just can't deal with this right now.
Can I go?
Yeah, just get the hell out of here.
Get out of here, Skippy.
My name is Mitchell. I'm not Joe.
Get out of here.
Sorry.
Just get out of here, please.
All right, Johnny?
Yeah, I'm okay.
This guy wasn't going to buy no computer. He's going to rip you off.
That was the craziest thing, was that while I was basically writing Good Time with Ronnie and bouncing stuff off of Benny was basically... cultivating this pilot with the producer in LA and bouncing stuff off of me, and then he was like, all right, we have to go to LA now, we have to pitch it. Yes, it was kind of like sold as like an autobiographical, but it is largely autobiographical, but I'm trying to push it as far away from me at least as possible. Of course, Benny knows there's some jokes in there that... that I will claim are far away from me, but...
But it's largely about your dad.
Yeah, it's about, It's about this guy and his two good friends who happen to be his children.
Yeah, it's about two sons whose friend happens to be their father. That's really what it
their
is.
Their mooching friend.
They live in the same city, and he happens to be their father. It's like just a matter of, like, oh, who's that guy? Oh, he's our dad. What? It's like... That kind of uncertainty about family is a very strange thing.
There was this story.
And
Her grandmother told us she was in Carl Schultz.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God, yeah.
She was sleeping on a bench.
She was in Carl Schultz. No,
it's not funny. I don't want
this,
that.
No, I won't say that one. She was in Carl Schultz Park, and all of a sudden, this guy jumps up.
In a bikini.
Out of the bushes in a thong.
Oh, that's right.
Sunbathing. I'm like by the East River in the FDR with his girlfriend. And she's like, oh, Alberto.
It's like...
Mom! He still thinks of it as his mom, like his mother-in-law, even though they've been divorced for 25 years.
25
More than that, 40 years.
30 years they've
Whatever,
been divorced.
Whatever, it's crazy. But just seeing him, like, see her over the bushes.
She still has a fondness for him.
She loves him, because she knows he has a good heart.
I was born in Italy, and I spent the first 5-6 years in Italy, and then I moved to France, Paris, and it was a bad move for me because it took me a while to get adjusted. It was kind of sad because they separated with my brother when I was young. When we moved to Paris, my brother went to like boarding school, and I stayed with my parents. So I didn't have the luxury of having an older brother with me, you know, in the house and play around. My father was nice enough to say, okay, listen, I want you to have a degree. And I pay for it. So he sent me over here. That was very nice of him. And I came to New York City and I never left.
Where did you meet Josh and Benny's mom? Here.
Here.
In New York.
In a pastry shop. We didn't plan anything. It just happened. And I was scared. And, you know, I didn't know what to do, but she was pregnant and we had the child. Then we were about to like really like split, and then she got pregnant again with Ben. And then we separated. Yeah, I used to hide my camera because that was my toy. You know, it's like a car you don't want to lend to your son because it's your toy. But they always used to find where I was putting the stuff away. And I used to use it, unbeknownst to me, to do stuff. And I was always scared it was going to break the lens, break this, a wire, the battery. And I used to, like, walk back from work. And I see a setup. I see Josh with, like, this hat, mugger's hat, you know, with dog glasses, his hands up, and then bend like that, you know, like, hands up. I said, what the hell? We're shooting a movie, he's telling me. I said, no, watch it. It was really funny. The camera was always part of our family, you know, and we went on vacation, was with us. We went skiing, was with us. And they were bothered by it sometimes, you know, enough filming. And I was always filming. I didn't care.
Get the bucket and get some sand. Okay,
I got the bucket of sand. Alex, now what do you want me to do?
Go up on the ladder.
Okay, go up.
And then take it down on the slide.
Take it down the slide.
And pour it down the slide.
But that's dumb and weird.
No, do it. Do it. It'll be cool. For our movie.
I didn't want him to grow up the way I grew up with my brother. So very quickly I told him, he's the closest thing you're gonna have in your life. And you're gonna be best friends for life. And I'm glad they're together. And I could see how they were arguing back then and how they argue today. Still the same pair of brothers that love each other. They're both passionate about it, they respect each other, and they always make up when they have the fight. You know, I had them very young. They went back to their mother, when they were bar mitzvahed, you know, 12 or 13 years old. And I didn't really leave those adolescent years, which are important. That's when you see the formative years of becoming a man, and I wasn't there. And there was, Amy was there, and there was their stepfather was there, and I think he played a big role in what they are today also. I think we all did. I had a small conversation with him over text the other day, and then I realized we all had our 2 cents in them becoming what they are. You know, it's like a cocktail of people, and we gave them the best, each one of us, of what we have to become what they are.
Hey,
hey,
quick, ooh, catch it. Come on, guys, come on in. Guys,
what's
come on
happening?
In. Listen to me, okay? Listen to me very carefully, all right? This is a surprise, okay? We are moving. We have 10 minutes to bring everything down to 36th Street.
What do you mean?
Just what I said. We are moving to a much bigger apartment.
What about the
Listen to me.
What about the
Listen to me. Listen to me. We have 10 minutes to go downstairs to a truck that is going to move us to a bigger apartment, okay?
I like this apartment.
You were embarrassing me in front of Mark.
When you saw Daddy Longlegs, though, for the first time.
He gave me the tape, the CD, and I didn't want to watch it. I was staring at me.
Okay, you knew, let's step back, so that you knew that they were making an autobiographical.
He said, we're going to make you a star, Dad. That's what he said. I didn't know what they were doing. Ben said that, you know, Benny's like that, you know. Start. He's like the businessman, you know, manipulating people around. One night it was like very late, it was 11 o'clock at night, and I was here. And he started to like push the CD in the computer and watch it. And I watched it. And what's amazing is that I didn't know he was traveling to Cannes. When the movie stopped, okay, and the credits starts rolling, the phone rings. And it's Josh. I just landed in Nice. So it was a very magical moment. And I told him I watched the movie and we both started crying. That was incredible because the movie was like very tough. It's a movie that builds you up, you know, slowly. And at the end, you know, you can't take, you know, when you see that this guy, you know, hunchback with a fridge, you know, and taking off to Queens in that cable car with the music.
Frey, I need you to cooperate right now.
This is all gonna be over in 5 minutes, okay?
No!
Come on, I'm not kidding.
Get off!
God damn
get
it.
Off!
All right, I'm ready to go.
Get off! Get off!
Stop it. Stop it. I'm not kidding. Stop it. Listen to me.
Good afternoon. If you are standing, hold on, please, while the cabin reports.
It was beautiful. It was a fabulous movie. I watched it so many times. And every time I watch it, I see a different angle. And you actually see how kids amplify everything. You know, they're not like us. If you give a small slap on the head of a kid, for him, maybe it resonates like a big hammer on his head. You have to be very careful. They're gentle creatures, you know?
Sun Star Radio.
I like that you did the reverb yourself today.
Is there something wrong with
that?
No.
It sounds very sexy already. I like it.
Yeah, this is...
Oh, my God. Pamela Anderson just called me sexy.
No, no, she said
I said
sounded
the show, the
sexy.
Oh, okay.
I wish that you could meet Benny. You haven't met Benny, right?
No.
He's so sweet. You'd love him. You really would. I mean,
well,
he's...
he sounds like a great dad, so I already
he is
him.
An unbelievable father.
Hello. Hello.
He wants you.
Are you calling?
Press the number button to call your friend.
He's been doing this a lot. Like, he hands you the thing, and then he's like, no, they're calling you.
Where did
I feel like
from?
I should have three scars. One on the forehead, one here, from this, like getting punched in the face, and then maybe on, like, the chin.
Yeah, I was going to say
the chin.
All right.
One, like, bubble
yeah,
scar.
Let's do one.
We could just do one
so maybe
of
just,
these. And
think about it. Where would it be? Well, they were punching, the kicking in the face, punching me in
the
nose.
Have the picture.
Yeah.
This one's already pressed down, but this is a little one.
Okay, let's do that.
The backstory is elaborate. They get separated about when their mother dies, and the older brother goes to live with an uncle who has like a car dealership, and he goes up in Yonkers, and the brother with disabilities goes to live with the grandmother, but it's too much for the grandmother, and they have a lot of altercations. He breaks her arm at one point. Yeah. He has a rage issue. I mean, we see it in the movie. My brother's preference is that nobody thinks of him as an actor, and he's gonna be in character. He studied for this character for many years, and he worked with some people with disabilities. So he would much rather not everyone be staring at him like, is he trying to do, okay.
I'll treat him like that
okay.
off camera.
Yeah, well, he's staying the same character the whole time, yeah.
One thing I want to also run by you guys, it might be cool if it was uneven, because, not like, well, hold on.
Well, I think this is like a Supercuts thing, like he goes in there and the grandma says, shave it.
Okay.
I know they sell them at Walgreens. And you can even return it afterwards. I'm not kidding. That's what I did when I bought a razor, and then I was gonna return it, but it was all on sale.
I don't even know if this one's doing anything.
I feel something.
It's like coming off a little bit, but I think this is like a...
No, it's definitely doing something.
Is it hurting?
It's pinching.
Sorry.
It's all right.
This one's probably going to pull a little bit.
Yeah.
put your stuff down on all the chairs over
What's
here?
What's your name?
I'm Michael.
I'm Mara.
Oh,
nice
my
God. Very
nice to meet you.
You put your stuff, like,
how
here.
Many of these did you get?
Enough.
Got to. Doors keep opening.
Yeah!
We're gonna go high, Cosmo.
The thing is, now it's very important because I get him, I feed him, and then I go. As soon as he naps, I go to sleep. I get like an hour and a half to edit. But in that hour and a half, it's impossible to procrastinate because I know that there's a set time that I have to be done. And that he'll wake up at any moment. So the focus has to be so sharp. So yeah, I just put Cosmo to sleep. And now is the time where I have the most amount of time to be able to kind of edit. This one, I know the last one is the best one. Because it's tail slated. I remember looking at Sean. Because it was just like, it was really awkward. It was like, okay, Josh just comes up to me, he's like, I need you to cry. And I was like, okay, and I can do that. It just, I have to go into this really dark place. And then something triggers this kind of like, it starts shaking in my head. And I'm like, okay, that's what's going to do it. And I just focus on that, and I just focus on that. And then eventually, I can feel it starting to affect my face, and then I can start, then I'll be like, okay, it's gonna happen. I remember looking at Sean, I just went like this.
I almost went to school for physics, and I was gonna be a physicist. So that's why I didn't see anybody, I didn't do anything that you would normally do in high school. I was just focusing on work. And then it was just so I decided it was the science research thing. So I decided to take up dark matter, because I was interested in it frightened me, this idea that the universe was out there and we couldn't see it. I wanted to know about it. So I was like, okay, let me learn about dark matter. I read all these books by Kepler about the musical orchestration of the universe and how he thought it was built. Then I started getting into film towards the end of high school. But this one teacher I had was like, okay, the part of the class was you'd learn about it, you'd read these insanely dense articles about it. And they were 30, 40 pages long. We'd have to summarize them and then teach them to the class. So you had to then internalize it and then externalize it in a way that was, you could teach it to somebody. And I like that process more than I actually like the mathematical aspect of it. So I was really into telling people the story of physics. So he was I remember he drew this chart on one of my papers. He said, this is point A, this is point B. He said, it goes like this. And he did all these crazy lines. It's fine. So you do all these crazy lines. He said, as long as you have one line that goes from point A all the way to point B, and you can walk me through that line, we're okay, you're fine. And then I was like, that was narrative storytelling. I was like, that was it. And then at the time I was watching a lot of Buster Keaton, which was the same way. You got all this madness and craziness. And then at the end, it all made sense. It didn't matter what happened in between, as long as you had one little thing that you could follow. So I kind of put that together.
Ay, 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 Ferris, why?
Yes, man. That's a good one, eh? Fuck, what? Yes, man.
Asshole. Well, I was living alone in Boston, and I was it was a strange schedule. I was only going 4 days a week of classes, and they're always late in the evening. So I could stay up all night, and I was just I became friendly with the guy who worked at the gas station, and I saw this kind of subculture of immigrants that were like Muslims and all these people who worked there, gas station attendants or cab drivers, or they would all just come in and they would have a little fun and they would go back to work, and he would be sitting there all by himself. And then one day he looked at me and said, like, I was like, all right, I'm gonna go back upstairs. And he looked at me like, what are you gonna do upstairs? And I was like, you're right. I had nothing to do. So I was like, I'm just gonna hang out here with you. And that became like a normal thing. And it was just like, it was amazing. It was a beautiful thing. I was like, he accepted me into his world, and we got really close. And he agreed to be in the movie. After I finished, I sent it to Cannes, just like nothing, like nothing. And then I got a phone call and they said it was accepted. And I was like, oh my God, this is incredible. And I tried calling Josh 500 times, fast asleep, didn't answer his phone. Then they call me back 45 minutes later and they're like, hello, is this Josh? And I was like, no. They said, oh, well, we're calling because The Pleasure Being Robbed was accepted. And I was like, oh, that's my brother. And then I hear like all this stuff in French, like holding the phone. And they're like, your brothers? I said, yes. And then like holding more conversation. I said, okay, I'll tell him. I'll let you know. And so it was like, they didn't realize that we were brothers. And it was like, once they did, they kind of put them together and they played them together. And it was this amazing experience.
Hey, Mike.
Yeah, what?
Do you think I could have those two bags?
Two bags? What two bags?
The two bags that you promised me for the wake up.
What are you talking about, your wake up? It's not morning time. Why would I give you a fucking wake up? It doesn't make any sense.
Mike.
I promised you a wake up, and you didn't even go
Mike,
to sleep yet
listen
to
me.
Wake up.
I do two bags here, two bags here, two bags here. I want to feel fucking rushed, okay?
Oh, so you
just want to feel fucking rushed, right?
You
yeah,
do all
so
four.
Can I just get the
no,
two right
no,
now?
No, if you would have asked me for four bags to fill your fucking rush, I wouldn't have gave you shit.
If you were going to give me two now and then two in the morning, that's four, right?
Because you just want to get super fucking
yeah,
high.
Yeah, I do.
All right?
But I'm trying. Do you know how to do math?
Was Heaven Knows What a difficult movie for you?
It was for me, yeah.
To meditate your way into?
Yeah, because I didn't want to be in that world. It was like a frightening place for me. It was very dark and scary, and I didn't want to be there. And it was just like, every day I remember it was really difficult to just like enter this place and be with these, like, cause it was just like, it was a scary place, cause just drug addiction in general. And like part of it for me was I didn't want to romanticize it in any way. I didn't want this movie, I didn't want people to leave the theater and be like, oh, that's a cool lifestyle. I want to be a heroin addict, which some movies do, you know, like. They'll be like, oh, this is so cool to do drugs. Like, I'll expand my mind, I'll do this. It's like, I didn't want that to be the case. I wanted to see you to see what I was seeing and what I was feeling. And I think that's actually me and Josh kind of like balancing each other out, because he saw a lot of beauty in that world and in the people.
Could you talk about the different sense of, or what you would identify as Josh's sensibility and your sensibility?
In a way, I guess you could say he's more, I can put it, let's just say, let's look at Daddy Long Legs as an example. Attitude towards our father, you know, he's a little bit more forgiving and romantic in his view of him, and I'm much more critical and just kind of matter of fact about it. And so you put those two together and you get an honest portrayal of a human being. You know, you get the loving side and you get the critical side. So in a way, that's how we approach it, and he can approach something. He'll be very bombastic and like gregarious about something, and then I'll look at it and I'll be more practical, or I'll look at it and say, hey, wait, this, or I'll bring humor to it in a way that he wouldn't necessarily see that there would be humor. And it's just kind of just that, in a way, like, yeah, we don't live the same way, so we don't see things the same way, but we complement each other. He'll let me see things that I don't see. I'll see things that he doesn't see. So it's like we kind of fill in each other's blind spots.
It's good. It's fully.
This is all about numbers, man. If you got numbers, you can play this game, you know?
All about numbers.
191, you know, like, you know, Nike will pay for it,
but people down the block stay open later.
Some stores, no?
The greedy stores.
Raffaello.
There you go, Raffaello.
Yeah, there's some real 47th Street beef.
Yeah, but there's nobody, like, as a sneakerhead growing up, like, you know, like, I didn't skip out on details. And I started making shit, and then I would catch them doing down the block, and they'd be like, fucking skip out on so much detail. And then, like, when everyone started making sneakers and hats, it's like, let me just got here. Let me enjoy myself. Right. Like, why are you guys with the fucking same shit?
Yeah, but that's gotta keep on. They gotta keep put fire on your ass. That's the game.
You know what I'm saying?
You know, they're gonna come, and then you gotta keep going.
Sibo, do you wanna tell Alec to meet us at Raffaello?
Yeah, I'm gonna talk to you guys.
All right. Gabe here? No, he's not here today? You remember me? How are you? How are you? I know, well, I'm back. I'm gonna make the movie finally.
Oh.
Yeah.
You can't, well, he's not here.
No, I'm not making it today. They're making a documentary.
My guy. How you doing?
Long time.
How you been?
Good.
Okay. He's saying where we've been. We've been making other movies. Since we tried to make this movie, we made two other movies.
Double check on the
money.
Yeah.
Boom. See, Uncut Gems. That's the title of the movie. Jacob, obviously. These are the characters. So, you know who that is. I took this image of Gabe, like years ago. Amare, who's in the movie.
Black Jew.
A$AP Ferg. This is a director named James Toback. This is a relative of mine.
You gotta find a more Jewish name for the guy, though.
Howard.
Yeah, last name is a more Jewish.
Howard Nagy? Ratner is the other idea. Howard Ratner. But that's Ashkenazi.
You gotta go from a Bohemian.
I know, of course I know that. Because it's from Forest Hills.
You gotta add an Ayev, Bayev, something.
I know, you make it kind of Russian. Wow, I really, is that Andrew Jackson? I think that's Andrew Jackson.
Why didn't they put his name on there?
You don't need to, because you deal with 20s so much.
Hair.
Yeah.
Signature.
I mean, at first I thought it was Beethoven. Let me put it on my chain here. This is kind of incredible. I mean, how much is this?
You have the chin?
Yeah, let me see the tag. It's right here.
If you go by tag price, no problem. You can pay me full price. I don't mind.
No, so what? This has 17.6. So what? You take 8? 8.5?
Don't be cheap.
And your next move, you're gonna put no more next.
Some stuff in here from a former relationship. First stuff we did, a lot of kids make horror movies when they're kids, you know, like they get access to a camera, you make the first thing, you know, the most formulaic shit that you can do is a horror film. I mean, I really like horror movies, but it, you know, it's just, that's why kids do it first, because it's A plus B equals C. For some reason, Benny and I, we get the first stuff that we did, which I haven't been able to find in all those tapes, it was fake documentaries. We just were like always coming up, we were trying to like make something super real, and
but this is before you even got into
this college. Was when I was like 10 years old. Yeah, 10 or 8 years old. I looked from a very, very early age. Our dad basically imposed upon us. He projected upon us an importance of movies that basically life's answers, the questions to life can be found in movies. The cards were stacked against my dad. He had no shot at winning custody. He didn't have a stable job and like, so he, kind of prepped us emotionally for that. And he was like, you know, I'm gonna show you a movie. We were young kids. She put Kramer versus Kramer on. And he's like, I am Dustin, and he said very explicitly, I am Dustin Hoffman and your mother is Meryl Streep. And we watched this movie and then that weekend we had to go see our mom. We were just vilified. So Dustin Hoffman was he was like our surrogate father. And then like, I forgot what year Hero came out, Stephen Frears movie. I think it was like 92, I must have been 8 years old or something like that. And that's another movie where he's like a deadbeat dad who cares and tries so hard and, you know, and like his moral lies deep within, it's not externalized, and he'll let Andy Garcia take, you know, all the credit for something that he actually did. It was my dad was doing deep shit, using film as a propaganda tool. The end goal is to make feature films. Like, that was it for me. I was like, I just want to make these things that, like, my father idolized. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to make these, it was heroic to me. So I was like, I need to do this. So how can I do it? So I was like, all right, I got to figure out a way to slowly step up and make that. So, like, I'm just going to inundate myself with short films and, like, constantly making stuff. I was constantly shooting things and trying to understand where things belonged. And I had, like, a pretty good sense of where I wanted to put the camera all the time, even when it's just filming something like a prank. But I just, like, wanted to just, you know, keep shooting and shooting and shooting until I understood what my voice was in a weird way. And then there was, like, a short that I did called Alberto Lives in a Bathroom. And that was, like, the first, there was like a black and white 16mm Bolex movie, and there was something about it that kind of felt very right to me. I don't know what it was. I think it was like diving headfirst into autobiography or biography, and then we're going to the zoo, just like everything just kind of came together, and all of a sudden I just like immediately knew, like, this is the language that I want to speak. This is how I want to say it.
She's a beautiful girl.
Sorry?
She's a beautiful girl.
She is a beautiful girl, actually, yeah.
You know, if you're having sex with a woman without you getting married with her, it's a very bad thing.
Yeah, okay.
Seriously, God, it doesn't like those people having sex with a woman before they get married. I mean, it's a very, very bad thing.
Oh.
But as soon as you get married with her, you can do whatever you want. I mean, whatever sex you want with her, but without you married, that's very bad things.
Okay. We're going to the zoo, I think, like a year or two after I made it, it got into South by Southwest, and I went to this festival. There was one programmer who was like, really dug the short, and he kept telling me, you have to see Frownland.
I have to leave my apartment based on the judgment of some diseased freak? I mean, you are fucked. You are so backward, man. I have never met a more fucked up, confused, diseased motherfucker. I mean, you are a worthless piece of shit.
I just want to live in a place where the bills are paid.
They are paid.
On time.
I missed the screening, and then I was like leaving the next day or something like that. But I went to like the award ceremony. I don't know why, but I went to it, and Ronnie won for Frownland. And the programmer who was like trying to connect us said, I come over here, I want you to introduce this guy. And I saw Ronnie my first day when I was checking in. I saw him leaving the convention center. I had no idea who he was. I was like, wow, that, I remember telling Sam, I was like, that guy is incredible looking. He's just amazing, like a face out of like a, I always said he always looked like a, he was like a silent movie. He looked like the type of guy who was like this, a silent movie star who did like one movie and was too difficult and no one would work with him.
Ronald. Bronstein, your first film, Frownland, I wanted to discuss a little bit before we kind of got into the new stuff. It seems as if it's a pretty intensive character study about people who just kind of can't really function around each other.
Does anybody ever like reading or listening to somebody talk about process, you know?
I remember seeing Frownland for the first time at Anthology Film Archive. And I remember very specific, it was like a keyhole into, like, in a weird way, like, my future. I just knew that I wanted him to be in something. I remember asking him to play a father, and he was so offended. He's like, oh, you think I'm old.
You know what? I'm not entertaining this discussion. Hello? Hello? This is my screw-up. I'm entitled to screw up in my 2 weeks, and you can screw up for the rest of the year, okay?
I don't screw up.
In this case,
screw up.
Right, you don't screw up. Okay, fantastic. Say goodbye to your mom, guys.
You know, Ronnie's performance, like, Benny and I, like, that we were ruthless with our sentiment. Like, we wouldn't allow ourselves to become sentimental, you know, because the last thing we wanted to do. And just like, we were crying making that movie. There was so many takes where we were crying at the end of the takes. You know, and like, I remember like our barometer was whenever we were shooting on the street is if someone didn't come up and like, you know, ask us if they could intervene, like this, the fight between Ronnie and Leah, like people just, we wanted people to just, we were obsessed with this idea of people thinking it was real. I mean, obviously, and heaven knows what, we took that to, like, you know, an absurd level almost, you know what I mean? Like, no one even knew there was a movie going on half the time. Benny always likes to say, like, when people ask him, like, what is it like to work with your brother? He likes to point out that we have no qualms about arguing. You know, we'll argue with each other, you know, in front of everyone. And we'll embrace in our shorthand, and, you know, it still feels like, that's why I want to continue to work with him, is that it still feels like we can be 10 and 8 again, you know what I mean? But just as adults.
I don't know how chemistry works. Something about these two guys, you know. Some people, they just naturally sort of, very naturally allow you to be the sort of best version of yourself, because that's the part of you that they see. And you know, just at a point where I was kind of ready to bow out, it just so happened that, you know, it started with Josh asking me to perform, which I hadn't done before. And of course, you know, I fought that tooth and nail. And it was just, you know, it's a complete counterphobic thing. You know, there was nothing in me. I don't have any inner drive to throw myself out there. It was just, well, what kind of person am I if I say no? Well, if I say no, it's because I'm frightened. And I don't want to see myself as frightened. So again, in some sort of counterphobic way, I'm doing things not because I want to, but because I don't want to be the person who wouldn't want to. So, you know, that turned into what was an acting, you know, job, essentially turned into a writing job, and then it turned into an editing job, and then things have sort of progressed naturally. Josh is an entirely incontinent force, you know? He's, you know, people really, I think people in general, like, value anal retention as a sort of the operative metaphor for what they look for in an artist, you know? And they laud that, you know? And unfortunately, that completely overlooks, you know, anal repulsion, you know? Which in my mind is, I don't know, that's a sort of more, that's what I look for in the work that I see. And I certainly, Josh is maybe the most anally repulsive creator that I've ever, you know, that I've ever come across, you know? That's not to mean that he's not exacting, you know? He has excellent instincts. But the problem is he's always... while he's always shitting everything out, he's also always taking in new influences, so that no idea ever sort of hardens and scabs over, you know? The ideas are always, always moving and living and breathing, and they don't stop, you know? Benny, on the other hand, Benny is like continence incarnate, you know? He is very logical. He's very stolid in his thinking, very rational, but there's like a pathology there, you know? It's not, it's like he's covered himself in kind of polyurethane so that he won't cry all the time, you know? After Frownland, I started a new project, and Benny was gonna be one of the lead actors in it, and every time he got into character, he'd start crying. I mean, I had to shut the entire project down because he wouldn't stop crying. I mean, that's not true, but I shut it down just because I didn't have the fortitude to continue. I couldn't find any money for it. But he's such an emotional person.
What would you have felt if you had hurt your grandmother? How would that have felt?
I don't know. She would be her fault.
Okay.
Yeah, she would have been in a way where I threw it.
Is it upsetting to you to think about hurting your grandmother?
No.
Okay.
And when you think of that, like, sort of incontinence versus continence, like, you would think, ideally, that that would create a perfect sort of vacuum-sealed checks and balances system so that they wouldn't need anybody else, you know? And it's not like my role here is just to sort of manage those two, you know? So you wouldn't think there would really be a need for them to have a third collaborator, but it just so happened that organically, things have progressed in this way where you know, they look to me for my input. And I don't know what that is. I mean, it's probably my ability to achieve suspension of disbelief is so busted up. I mean, it's gone to rot, you know? And that insensitivity or it mixed a little bit with malice, you know, for movies in general, they make me sort of like dive headfirst into bad ideas, you know? Like, what are the wrong ideas in any given situation, in any given sort of creative term where you have to make a decision? Like, what is, in a way, what's the most wrong one? And I think Josh is really attracted to that, you know, that sort of perverse imp in him really, really likes that. And he sort of values that in me. And then together we try to, you know, like, imbue that wrongness with as much confidence as possible.
So have a quick word straight away.
Hey guys, how are you? Taylor, how do you feel before showing the movie to the world? In Cannes, in the big theater.
I know.
No pressure.
one more back.
You want me to throw up for you? I'll do it.
Mr. Safdie, thank you very much, both of you. Robert Pattinson, the hero of the Safdie Brothers film, Good Times.
The regality to Cannes had, there's like a, I wouldn't allow it to induce a false sense of victory, because it's nothing. In the end of the day, it's an echo chamber.
I think it's the first time that we can actually see like one or two things ahead. And that's new.
Yeah, it's always been like the destination has always been gems, and now it's like, now we're starting to realize, like, we're going to arrive at Gem soon, finally.
The road doesn't stop there, where I thought...
For a long time, it was like, we're going to make this movie. We always joke we're going to be, like, 75 years old and be like, I've got gems. Let me tell you about this movie. You know, and now we finally have this somewhat of a semblance of, like, there will be a life after Gems, which is a new thought in our heads. So...
Shredding.
This guy's shredding right now.
Have you ever met Naya?
Yep, thank you.